really because we know that youth in our communities, in North Dakota, particularly in the Grand Forks area, because we serve Grand Forks County, are using vaping products or electronic nicotine products at some pretty alarming rates. And so one of the things that we can do to start addressing some of that increase is to start talking to you guys about what we know, because we feel like what we know, you guys might not necessarily know. But we also know that when we can come out and talk to youth, we will more than likely leave here knowing something that we didn't know. So please feel comfortable. Grand Forks Public Health does have this tobacco prevention program, and so some of the things that we have done to address other tobacco use are items like helping schools with their tobacco preschool policy, or passing laws and ordinances related to smoking and electronic vaping products. Some of those things, and you know, working with the state to run advertisements that kind of help create those messages that make sure that you guys know that tobacco use is not the norm and that it can be harmful to your health. So those are, that's kind of what we do. But we're here to talk a little bit about vaping. Oh, this happened last time too, so.
I can't reach it, it shuts off.
So we'll start off though, while Mr. G works on that, by talking about what we call vaping products. And so we've said the word vaping, we've said the word electronic nicotine delivery products or delivery systems, but what are some other words that you associate with electronic nicotine products?
E-cigs.
Yep.
Think about some specific name brands.
Juul.
Yep. Any other ones, just out of curiosity? Because those really are vaping, Juul, e-cigs, or e-cigarettes.
Mod
is another one. Yeah. Another one on our list that we have ENDS, e-cigs, vapes, mods, e-hookahs, and then Juul and Juuling. So you not only have the product that's Juul, but now people are using the verb, I'm Juuling, you know, so that's sort of another term too, we make sure parents know. But the other one we have on there is something new, maybe not well used, but we like to share it just because it's interesting, and it's PV. Does anyone know what PV would stand for? A personal vaporizer. So if they called it a personal vaporizer, one might think that that seems healthier or safer, but that is just one of the words in the list that we've just included. But there certainly could be called other things, but these are some of the ones that are more well known. And so these products are designed to deliver nicotine or other similar substances to the user in the form of an aerosol or vapor. So aerosol and vapor are basically just tiny droplets of liquid. And so when we talk about all of those terms that we just discussed that could be used to describe these products, they generally all have the same components. So they will have a battery, an atomizer, which is the actual device that makes the tiny liquid droplets, nicotine or another similar substance, and a mouthpiece. So they will always have those no matter what they look like. They all contain those same components. So when we first started learning about electronic cigarettes, we were like, what? Like a tobacco cigarette, but it's electronic. So when they first came out, they looked like a traditional cigarette.
So the traditional one is right here, right next to it is what the early versions of e-cigarettes look like.
So companies said, we feel like smokers want this type of nicotine. It's aerosolized, it's electronic. They only have to carry one thing around versus a whole pack, so it really was geared towards smokers, and it didn't really take off. Not very many people used them, so the companies redirected and came up with something more like this.
So what do you notice about these?
Colorful.
They're colorful? Yeah.
Different sizes and shapes.
And I don't know if anybody can read it, but it says grape, apple, so they started adding some flavors.
The initial ones were made to taste just like a traditional cigarette, and that they found people did not care for that at all. So they started adding flavors. They Some were reusable and rechargeable, some were one-time use and you throw them away, but kind of a variety of different things. And then after this sort of wave, or what they're calling generation, came something more like this.
Anybody know what that is? It's a mod.
So that's called a mod.
A mod version.
Which means you can modify it. So you can put different batteries, atomizers, and mouthpieces together to do different things. But this type of system would be more of a refillable system. So you would be using the little vials of e-liquid to fill that. But again, you can choose which flavor you want in there. After that is when these came on the scene. And they call these the fourth gen or pod mods. And so someone had referenced Juul. So that's represented here in the middle. I am certain you probably know that. Anybody seen or heard about any of the other three? Anybody know what those are?
I do.
Thorsen drop or the badge, smoke badge. Anyways, we have pointed out now, this is the fourth presentation we've done today, but the microphones that the teachers use here at Manville, that is roughly the size of the Thorsen drop,
which is
the same shape, same size. But a lot of individuals might not even know what they're looking at when they're looking at these devices. It looks like a school supply or something you might find in the junk drawer at home.
What does Juul specifically look like?
Yep, some kind of a USB storage device, yeah.
Yep.
So, and interestingly enough, they're sold with the chargers that most often Juul users will charge them in their laptop or in right in the, you know, the Apple box part of their charger. So we have a relationship with one of the professors at school at UND, and she said when she saw this that she didn't realize that college students were charging their electronic cigarettes in class because she had no idea what she was even looking at. So just getting familiar with what's on the market. But as soon as you do that, unfortunately, there's going to be something new on the market. So this is just kind of a snapshot of what we know today. Clearly is changing very quickly. So a lot of folks will tell you that it's just harmless water vapor. So we talked about the aerosol and the vapor being just small particles that are vaporized. These products really are not. We talk about this in a little bit here, but they're not regulated by the FDA, so they're not fully studied yet the way that traditional tobacco products are, but the preliminary studies that are being done are showing that the list of things that they're finding in these products, including Juul, contain a lot of the same harmful chemicals that are found in a traditional tobacco cigarette, number one being nicotine. We'll talk about this again in a little bit, but if there's one tidbit we want you to take away from today, is that all Juul products, so the actual Juul brand products, always contain nicotine. If you went to the Juul website, there is no option for 0% nicotine. So if someone is using a Juul and they're telling you that it's okay because it's flavored water or harmless water vapor, that is a completely false statement, because you will never find a Juul pod that is 0% nicotine. Other chemicals like volatile organic compounds or heavy metals, those are all found in traditional tobacco products. Heavy metals can cause some brain malfunction. Ultra fine and nanoparticles just means that the particle size of this vapor is even smaller than the particle size of what you would get from an inhale up of a traditional tobacco product. So this vapor is actually going way deeper into the lungs than a traditional tobacco cigarette smoke would. And that's what's potentially causing, now behind Kailee there's some letters there. And that's associated with a lot of what we're hearing and seeing on the news and media right now related to the lung injuries and deaths related to vaping. So EVALI, or what we're calling EVALI, is electronic cigarette or vaping associated lung injury. And that's the government is tracking these illnesses and deaths related to vaping. And so that's the acronym that they're using. But some of it is related just to the size of the particle that's getting getting down deep into the lungs.
And when we talk about flavors and we say FDA approved, that doesn't mean that they're FDA approved to inhale. A lot of these companies are misguiding the user by saying FDA approved, because the flavors that are in them might be FDA approved to ingest or go into your stomach. They're safe to eat, but they are not FDA approved to inhale or to go into your lungs.
So they're not approved for your lungs, plus they're making these particles so small that they go so deep into the lungs, and so some of those injuries are related to just the chemicals that are touching the tissues of the lungs that aren't supposed to be there. Our lungs are for oxygen. So that's just kind of a quick list of some of the things that we are finding in there. So it is not just harmless water vapor. And we kind of touched on this just now, but these products are fairly new. And when I say new, I mean that first traditional cigarette style e-cigarette came onto the market in the U.S. in about 2007. And now, obviously, we're much farther down the road and the products have evolved. But in that time frame, they've evolved so much that the government is having trouble keeping up with regulating them. So they aren't regulated the same way that traditional tobacco products are regulated. They don't have to follow the same rules. And so when we talk about those flavors and all of those other things that are found in there, there really isn't anyone checking to make sure that they know what's in there. The companies are trying to tell you that they have, you know, some lists of some of the things that are in their products, but no one is double checking even what they're saying is in the products. So we're kind of trying to play catch up here, and unfortunately, while we're trying to play catch up, we're seeing these dramatic increases in the number of people that are using them. So it's quite alarming. They are doing something, so we're calling it now under-regulated, but it's not to the level where we need it to make good decisions about these products. So this is some information about the youth risk behavior survey. So you guys may have taken this survey last spring. It's administered to middle school and high school students. So this information that we're showing you today is actually from high school students within the state of North Dakota. And so just to kind of give you a brief overview of what we're looking at here, the green bars are traditional tobacco product use, and the teal bars are electronic cigarette product use. And so if you just generally look at the green bars of traditional tobacco product use among high schoolers here in North Dakota, what do you see? The green ones are going down, right? Yep, so 35, 30, 29. So that's getting better. That means that what Kailee and I are doing to help prevent and reduce tobacco use through education and policy is actually working. But the unfortunate part, because electronic products are so popular right now, we are seeing the trend still increasing. And the two different boxes indicate those high schoolers who ever used a product. So what we're seeing is that folks in grades 9 through 12, more than half of kids in 9 through 12 have ever used an electronic product. And this is those that use them on at least one day in a month. So almost a third of kids are using them on at least one day of every month. And if we look at a little bit more frequent use, kids in grades 9 through 12, the increase between the last time the survey was taken and this time, there is dramatic increase in the kids that are using them on 20 of the last 30 days and kids that are using them on all 30 days. And so like up to almost 200% increase since the last time we asked kids about this, which means that kids are not just experimenting with the electronic products anymore. They have now become addicted and are using them on 20 or 30 days in a month.
Why do you think they're becoming addicted?
Nicotine. Yeah. And probably because they weren't aware that they contained nicotine. And we'll talk about that in just a little bit. So besides nicotine and addiction, any guesses on why young people are interested in these products?
Because they think it makes them cool.
And any guesses on how they're promoted or.
Friends.
Yep, that's part of it too. So the first thing we want to talk about with you is flavor. So we talked a little bit about the fact that flavor is in these products, but the majority of youth who ever tries an e-cig, so those that told us that they had tried, we asked them why they tried it. And one of the main reasons, so 97% of the kids that have claimed that they've tried a product say that they tried it because it had a flavor. They don't specify which flavor, but they just say the flavor is a big part of it. And so
what do these look familiar to anybody? So we got Watts e-liquid, which looks a lot like Mott's applesauce, right? We got cereal treats, looks a lot like Cinnamon Toast Crunch, right? We have Fanta, looks like Fanta Pop, right? So the point being is here, do you think these are marketed towards adults? Mm-hmm. No, those flavors are definitely have a youth angle to them by far. They not only look a lot like items you might have in your pantry at home.
For kids. I'm not saying I don't like Cinnamon Toast Crunch, but
right.
I buy it for my kids. So,
right.
Yeah.
But they also smell and taste like that too. So they are deliberately, those flavors are marketed a certain way.
Yeah. So this one is a little harder to understand, but we do want to tell you about it because it is something that is purposeful on behalf of the companies that make these products. The way that they're designed to use, instead of free-based nicotine, which is the burning of the actual tobacco in the traditional product, the way that this nicotine is designed in this device, particularly the Juul, is that it's a nicotine salt. So what that means is that instead of the reaction you would get if you experienced for the first time a traditional cigarette, if you inhaled smoke from a traditional cigarette for the first time, what is the reaction? What is the typical reaction of a young person experimenting for the first time with a regular cigarette? Does anybody know? I'm really glad that you don't know.
Yeah.
Coughing. If they were to use it, they would be coughing and they would feel like a really harsh burning sensation in their throat. They might actually feel kind of nauseous because sometimes that smoke gets into their stomach instead of into their lungs. Not a very good experience, which is okay because we don't want them to use traditional cigarettes anyways. But the companies that have produced these have created them in a way so that it doesn't have that harsh, gross feeling in the throat. It's much more smooth, and you couple that with the flavor and the smaller particle size, and it gets in deeper, and it has a very different feeling when you're using one of these versus one of these. And the companies know that, and they're doing that on purpose. Okay, so these are some examples of some folks that we know that use these products, and they use them very openly, which is a form of marketing. Does anybody know who this actor is?
Leo DiCaprio.
He is using it in the middle of an award ceremony that's being televised on TV.
Katy Perry.
Next couple are maybes. Katherine Heigl, she's an actress. She's using it during a talk show. She's being interviewed on talk show on TV using the product.
It looks like a cigarette, like a traditional cigarette, but it's actually one of the second set of pictures we showed that had more of like the vape pen style. She has something similar to that.
Yep. And that's Jenny McCarthy. And then we get into a little bit more about what their ads look like. So traditional tobacco products, the way that they are marketed, they are regulated. It's illegal for them to be running ads in magazines that are youth-friendly. They can't run ads on the radio or on TV anymore. But these products don't have to follow that same set of rules. So this ad, I think this one was maybe like a YouTube ad. But does this ad look like it was directed toward adults?
Mm-hmm.
What do you notice about the ad?
She's a teenager.
She looks very young.
Yeah.
And it's colorful and maybe like the pattern and shape of the, you know, the background is more something that would be appealing to youth. And the device itself, it's not one of those, you know, stick style where it's more something that would be more appealing to some younger folks.
Does anyone know where this is?
New York City
in Times Square. Think of all the people that are sitting there.
longer can promote sponsorships and sporting events, but these, because they don't have to follow the same rules, we're now seeing sponsorships in sporting arenas and events.
Anybody recognize any of these characters?
Cheshire Cat and Hello Kitty.
Hello Kitty.
Fortnite Llama.
Fortnite. And these are what are called skins, and those are to like customize a jewel. So do you think many adults want a Hello Kitty or Fortnite skin?
No.
No.
A couple of other Instagram influencers. So when we talk about the way that they're marketed, sometimes these people are paid to use the products and sometimes they're not. But even if they're not getting paid from the company, they are still marketing the product to all of their followers. So Bella, I know this is actually a video. She actually uses the product. And then Selena, it just has it tucked into her arm by her book. But just because she's carrying it gives that impression to whoever is following her that that's something that they maybe want to look more into. So that's an impression or an influence. They no longer have active social media, but Jewel was active on all platforms of social media. And interestingly enough, they tried to claim that they never marketed to youth. How many of your parents are on Snapchat? Maybe some. So do you think by advertising on Snapchat and Instagram that they're focusing on an adult target market?
Mm-hmm.
Not quite. Not quite. This was just a GTA Vape City, just showing that they're using they're pulling out all stops. They're marketing, I don't know how many, I'm not even sure who plays Grand Theft Auto, but I'm not sure that the 60-year-old male smoker is someone that they're marketing to with this. Another busy slide, but this just does show, let's focus on the red line, and this is the market share of electronic cigarette companies, and you can see by the legend on the side that the red line is Juul, and so they had almost 78% of the market share at the end of 2018. So that's telling us that of the products that were available at the time, Juul was the most popular. So around that time, when someone saw where this spike was going, a company called Altria wanted their stake of that company. They said, we need to get involved with them. Look at where their shares are going. They paid $13 billion with a B for a little more than a third of the company. So they didn't even buy the whole company. They bought 35% stake in the company for $13 billion. So any guesses
on who Altria is? Just a guess.
The same company that produces Marlboro cigarettes. So Altria is the same company that also owns R.J. Reynolds, who is also, or excuse me, Philip Morris, is the same company that owns now part of Juul. So Marlboro, Juul, highest ranking cigarette company, and now we have the highest ranking electronic cigarette company, and they have now married themselves together. So when we think about whether or not these products are similar or not, or whether we should be putting them in one category or two, they really are in that same basket. They are all tobacco products. Just another example. So after 2018, when people saw that Juul was the most widely used, all of the other companies started jumping on board and producing something similar. So the point being is whether it's a Juul or one of these other ones, generally it's a pod that contains nicotine. So we talked about the kids maybe not necessarily knowing that there was nicotine in them. So the folks, the high school students that reported using Juul, 63% of those kids that reported using that product had no idea that it contained nicotine. So even though it's the most widely used, they may have had no clue that there was nicotine in there. And those preliminary studies that we were talking about earlier were showing that one Juul pod contained as much or more nicotine as an entire pack of cigarettes. So
that's 20, there's 20 cigarettes in one pack of cigarettes. So one Juul pod is equivalent to the amount of nicotine in that whole pack. And it, depending on the user, just like a pack of cigarettes, that's how long, if somebody smokes often, their pack of cigarettes doesn't last very long, right? But if somebody, same thing with the Juul pod, depending on how often these users are using the product is how long that will last. And we've had reports of, you know, up to half a day. One pod will only last someone half a day. So it's very alarming when you start putting in context how much nicotine folks are getting. 5 minutes? So you know somebody that...
No, I'm saying you
have... Oh, I was like, oh my, got it, sorry. I thought you were saying 5 minutes.
Someone used to jewel pod.
Okay, yeah.
But we have had reports too. There's a 17-year-old advocate who used to use Juul and has now been treated and is now not using Juul, who is using 4 pods per day. So that's like smoking 80 cigarettes a day. So it's definitely something to pay attention to. This is just to highlight, there is a study that's been actually repeated now from NDSU. They're actually testing the electronic liquid vials in the state of North Dakota just to see if what is on the label is matching the contents of the vial. And they often found that it did not match. Sometimes it was lower and sometimes it was higher. They had one instance where the actual nicotine level was 172% higher than what was found in the vial. And that goes back to the industry is under-regulated. There is nobody checking to make sure that what is on the label is what is found in the vial. Not just the content, the percentage of the nicotine, but any of those other harmful chemicals. So we really have no idea what is in there. This just, social currency is kind of like social media, but what we're trying to say is that kids are telling us that kind of that idea that you're not cool unless you have a Juul. So we looked at these 100,000 tweets in 1 month to see what people were saying, and it was stuff like, life hack, if you're ever trying to make friends at a party, all you need is a Juul. Having a Juul at a party is the equivalent to opening a pack of gum during class in middle school. Or shout out to the girls who offered me a Juul hit in the bathroom because I was crying. So just this idea that this is what kids are thinking, which really not a majority of kids are in. There is a lot of kids using them, but it's still not a majority of kids. So when people tell you that everyone is using them, it is not everyone. But we are watching that trend, and it all comes down to nicotine and addiction. So other items that we're concerned about, we just mentioned nicotine, and we just want you to know that just the nicotine, so aside from all of those other harmful chemical substances that are found or that they're finding in here, just nicotine itself on the developing brain can have serious life consequences. If you introduce nicotine to a developing brain, which is anyone really under the age of 25, you can disrupt the growth of the circuits that have to do with attention and learning. You can lower impulse control and have behavior issues, but you also lower your susceptibility. And basically, you're priming your young brain for addiction to other substances. So just the nicotine themselves in those devices can be very harmful. But we have also talked about some poisoning issues. So just touching liquid nicotine, because it can be absorbed through the skin. We had a principal in Jamestown who confiscated a product from someone at school, and just by touching the device was sent to the emergency room because of nicotine toxicity. So that's how high the concentration levels of this nicotine can be. We've heard about explosions, so those mod devices, sometimes even the other ones, because they're not evaluated and regulated by the government for safety, can explode while they're being used, or they can explode while they're in your pocket. This guy's missing some facial hair and skin and teeth. We've also been tracking the use of other substances in these devices, and so basically what we're trying to say is we kind of told you what to look for, but be aware that someone that's using this thinking it's completely safe might not know what's in there, or they might know that there's something else in there, but if you see something, you should say something, because this can be extremely harmful. We're also watching items that we call it stealth vaping, but these companies are actually producing products that will help individuals hide their vaping product. Again, we're telling you this because if you see something, we want you to say something. What they're using may be more harmful to their health than they might actually know. So sweatshirts with the strings that are a vaping device, watches, smart watches now that are vaping devices. So there's a whole plethora of items out there that can be used to vape nicotine or other substances, and we just want you to know that you should be watching for that stuff and letting somebody know if you see something. This is just a quick snapshot of where the vaping associated lung injuries are to date. This is US. Over 2,000 people have been confirmed with the lung injuries. 42 people have died. Now this is actually from last Thursday. This information is updated every Thursday. Willing to bet if we looked, these numbers are higher, but they're not available at 8 o'clock in the morning before we came out. So basically the CDC is saying that the only way to make sure you're not at risk for a vaping associated lung injury is to not use any vaping product at all, no matter what your age.
And just to point out, there are 3 confirmed cases in Grand Forks. So it is happening here as well.
This is where you can report those vaping related illnesses to the Department of Health. So what are we doing about it? This, we're educating folks, because most often you guys, kids as your age, have no idea what's going on with these products, because they're getting the social currency from their friends thinking that this is where they need to be, this is what they need to be doing. In reality, we should be listening to folks like the Surgeon General, Food and Drug Administration, the CDC. They're the ones that are actually testing these products and figuring out what's actually in them. So we need to make sure we're looking for the right information. There are resources out there, especially for teens on vaping. If you're looking for just information in general, My Life, My Quit is a good place to go. But this is actually a teen-specific cessation tool as well. And they do have text capabilities. So if you know somebody that is looking for help stopping vaping, this would be a place to send them. This is actually where we can send parents for help if they use a product. You can be younger and use this resource, but the My Life, My Quits is the most recent resource for youth. And then we talked about policy earlier, so Manful Public Schools includes electronic products in their policy. It is also illegal for anyone under the age of 18 to purchase or possess these products. Talked about that nicotine in the developing brain and being under 25, so some places are looking at increasing the minimum legal sales age of tobacco products, including electronic products, to 21 to sort of help curb some of that addiction. Increasing the price never hurts, because if something's more expensive, you tend not to buy it. Making sure that those that are selling these products are actually selling to those who are of age. And maybe looking at restricting some of those flavors that are enticing to youth. And that is all we have. So I know that there wasn't really a lot of opportunity for questions, but if you have questions, feel free to ask. If you have questions, feel free to share that with someone at school and they can get back to us. We can make sure to answer those. There are some resources. We do have some My Life, My Quit handouts for everyone to take, so that if you have it and you know someone that could use it, you can share that with them. And then we do have a few of the parent handouts left too, so if you think your parents are interested in this information. And I believe the video will